We respectfully acknowledge that we are on Treaty 6 territory, traditional lands of First Nations and Métis peoples. As Treaty people, Indigenous and non-Indigenous, we share the responsibility for stewardship of this beautiful land. And now I will hand it off to Vicky.
Thank you, Christina. And thank you to all of our attendees for joining us today. This is our last Zoom town hall meeting. My name is Vicky Dodge, and I'm the senior planner with the City of St. Albert. I've been working with the city doing project management for this annexation file. The purpose of this town hall meeting is to share information and to receive as many questions from you as possible and hopefully answer as many as we can in the time that we have. We have about an hour for today's meeting, but before we get to the presentation part, I have to go over a few housekeeping items. This meeting is being recorded. The information in this session is being collected under the authority of Section 33C of the Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act for the purposes of administering the city's public participation events. The use, retention, and/or disclosure of all information collected by the City of St. Albert is protected by the provisions of the Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act. The recording of this session is intended to be shared on the city's website and may end up on the social media platforms as well. So you as attendees, your video is not enabled and we cannot see you, and your image will not be recorded. You are also on mute, and you will only be unmuted if you are identified to speak a question during the question and answer period. If you speak a question, your voice will be recorded. If you have any technical difficulties, please use the chat function to describe the challenges you're having, and we'll do our best to help sort that out for you. You should find it at the bottom of your screen if you're using your laptop or a computer, and I think you have to do a little bit of swiping if you're on a mobile device of some kind. So all the comments in the chat space and in the question and answer later on will be transcribed and could be made public as well. So with those housekeeping items out of the way, I'd like to introduce our panel who is here to help answer your questions today. Just double checking. It looks like we have almost everyone here today. So we have Darren Young from ISL Engineering, and Darren is the technical expert who will be fielding the more technical kinds of questions. Greg Weiss from Corbis Business Advisors is the financial expert on the panel today. And Christina Peter, who opened the meeting, is the manager of planning, the city's planning branch, and will be addressing most of the land use and future planning questions. We also have joining us today, Councillor Sheena Hughes, who's representing the city's annexation negotiating committee, and Councillor Bokenfor from the county, who is representing the county's annexation negotiating committee. And I'm just seeing that I don't think Councillor Bokenfor has joined us yet. So hopefully he's able to join in soon. Okay. So for consistency across the three town hall meetings that we were having this week, we decided to pre-record the presentation that you're about to see. The following presentation is about 10 to 15 minutes long. I don't remember exactly how long it is, but that should leave us plenty of time for question and answers afterwards. So that we don't miss any of the questions, please don't type them into the question and answer box yet. Just wait till the presentation's finished. We don't want to miss anything. So I'll ask our City of St. Albert support, Beth Frigo, to please load up the presentation now. You shall see it shortly. Thank you for joining us today for what is one of the last formal opportunities to learn about the outcomes of this annexation project and about the upcoming application review process with the Municipal Government Board. The purpose of today's meeting is to share information and key outcomes of the annexation negotiations, as well as to answer as many questions as we can in the hour that we have. As you may already know, this project started in April of 2017 when the City of St. Albert gave notice of its intent to annex land from Sturgeon County. Since then, much work has been undertaken in support of the city's annexation application, including interviews with affected owners and agencies, open houses, questionnaires, and technical background studies. Along the way, the city has tried to keep interested parties informed of developments through regular media releases, updates to its website, and through newsletters. In August, the Annexation Negotiating Committee, which comprises three elected officials and the CAO from each municipality, concluded its negotiations and reached an annexation agreement. The agreement was approved by the councils of the City of St. Albert and Sturgeon County shortly after that. The city is now preparing its formal application package that will be submitted to the Municipal Government Board in early December of this year. In the city's intent to annex notice, we saw the first suggested annexation boundary called the maximum potential annexation area. This boundary was loosely based on prior intermunicipal planning discussions between the two municipalities and was established as a starting point for negotiations. The maximum potential annexation area is shown on this map with a black dashed line. The Annexation Negotiating Committee considered additional information gathered from the public during the November 2019 open houses, as well as the growth and development needs of both the city and the county, in order to arrive at the final negotiated annexation boundary shown on this map with a red dashed line. This boundary was presented publicly in April of 2020. This boundary comprises approximately 1,588 hectares, or 3,923 acres, and has a 45-year land supply. This land supply includes both residential and non-residential land supply estimates. We'll note that there are no growth or development plans for River Lot 56 or for the Poundmakers Lodge. In addition to the boundary, the Annexation Negotiating Committee decided on a number of other important matters, including compensation, road jurisdiction, taxes, and a commitment to as smooth a transition as possible for former county residents. The city and the county agreed to a compensation amount of $600,000, and that all roads and road rights-of-way shown in green on this map would transfer to the city. This includes all roads along the boundary of the annexation except for portion of Township Road 544 in the northwest corner. Taxation was a dominant concern that came up at the prior open houses. The Annexation Negotiating Committee agreed to a 45-year tax protection. In other words, starting in the year the annexation becomes effective, which is proposed to be 2022, former county owners will pay the lower of county or city taxes unless a shift to the city tax rates is activated. A shift to city tax rates is activated in three ways. First, if an owner requests a subdivision approval that would result in more than four parcels on a quarter section. Second, if an owner requests a redistricting or rezoning of their property. And last, if an owner requests to be connected to city water, sanitary sewer, or both. The next few slides will be reviewing various transition topics. These are the day-to-day topics that came up as main themes at the last round of open houses. There's a topic that you have in mind that's not discussed here, please bring it up during the question and answer period. Let's start with land use. A number of people at the last round of open houses were concerned that the way they use their land will change after annexation or that they'll be forced to develop. What's being proposed is that people will continue to be able to use their land in the same ways they would have been permitted to use the land under the existing agricultural district. No one is going to be forced to develop their land if they don't want to. The city will apply its own land use district on the newly annexed land, but that land use district would be a blend of the county's existing agricultural district and the city's urban reserve district. This would be allow for flexibility so that you can still use the land in the same ways that you're used to, with some reasonable restrictions on future subdivision and development so that orderly and efficient urban development could occur in the future. The new land use district would need to be approved by City Council and would include a public process so that you would have an opportunity to speak your views before Council before a decision is made on that land use district. Another transition topic area is business licensing. The negotiating committee decided that all businesses in the annexation area, existing and new, will require a business license. However, to ease that transition, a five-year fee waiver would be in place starting with the effective date of annexation. Farming operations would remain exempt under provincial legislation. Pet licensing would fall under the city's animal control bylaw and requires all dogs to have a license, but cats are not licensed in the city of St. Albert. Emergency services would continue to be provided at usual levels, and the city and the county maintain mutual aid agreements to help with servicing rural areas. Municipal addressing would change to the city's addressing protocols, and the city would be able to enforce its own bylaws within the annexation area. Fire pits and controlled burning would follow the existing county rules until the area is developed to an urban standard, at which point the city's rules would apply.
noise control and RV parking would be subject to the city's bylaws. Off-road vehicles and ATVs will continue to follow the county's rules on public roadways until the area is developed to an urban standard. Mosquito control falls under the city's integrated pest management plan, and what this means is that the city uses an integrated approach to mosquito control that currently doesn't include spraying. The city of St. Albert does not allow fireworks to be set off unless you are a licensed pyrotechnician.
The concerns raised at the open houses last November focused on potential impacts to agricultural operations and the agricultural way of life. Specifically, we had questions about firearm use post-annexation for crop and livestock protection. We could confirm that firearm use on private land is regulated by the province of Alberta, and the annexation is not going to change that. However, firearm use on public land is prohibited in the city of St. Albert. Existing fuel storage tanks for agricultural operations will remain exempt from the city's bylaw and permitting processes. However, new installations will require prior city approval.
Outdoor storage for agricultural operations is exempt from city's bylaws. However, unsightly premises can still be required to put up fencing or some sort of screening if that's deemed necessary by the city. And noxious weed control falls under the city's integrated pest management plan, which notes that noxious weeds are addressed under the Weed Control Act of Alberta, and that act requires owners to control noxious weeds to prevent their propagation and spread. Many folks were wondering about the maintenance levels to expect on roadways after annexation, and we can say that roadways will be maintained to the same county standards as before annexation. Once urban development occurs, road maintenance will be in accordance with the city's standards for urban roadways. Also, road naming will be in accordance with the city's road naming protocols. And finally, household waste management was a concern that was brought up at the open houses last November. People living in the annexation area will be able to use the city's Mike Mitchell Recycling Center for household recyclables. This is located in the Campbell Business Park. As for household garbage, the city of St. Albert, in collaboration with Sturgeon County, is pursuing talks with Rose Ridge Waste Management Service Commission. This is the commission that manages the Rose Ridge landfill. Because the commission is an independent third party, the city and the county and the commission need to sit down and talk about ways to allow former county residents to continue to use the landfill until curbside garbage pickup is available in the city. In the annexation area, curbside pickup would likely not be available until urban development takes place.
This brings us to the end of the transition topics, and I'd like to provide you with information now about the upcoming Municipal Government Board application process and how you can get involved. But first, I'd like to define what the Municipal Government Board is. The Municipal Government Board is an independent and impartial quasi-judicial board established under the Municipal Government Act. Its job is to make decisions about land planning and assessment matters.
The Municipal Government Board is not the decision-making authority for annexations. That authority rests with the province of Alberta. Rather, the Municipal Government Board reviews applications for annexation, evaluates their merits, and then writes a recommending report to the Minister of Municipal Affairs. The decision from the province is called an order in council. As discussed at the beginning of this presentation, the next step in the annexation project is for the City of St. Albert to submit its application to the Municipal Government Board. Once the Municipal Government Board has the city's application, it will send notifications regarding the annexation to all the affected parties as well as to the public. And if an objection is received, then the Municipal Government Board will set a date and a time for a hearing to allow all people to have that opportunity to speak before the board. Anyone who feels they would like to speak before the board can register to do so with the Municipal Government Board. And this would be the last opportunity to have your input heard in this annexation process. So once the Municipal Government Board has concluded its hearing process, it will compile its findings into a recommendation report and send that to the Minister of Municipal Affairs seeking a decision. If the province decides to approve the annexation, the city would be notified, and we expect that notification to come in by the end of next year. The city has asked for an effective date of January 1st, 2022. And once that decision is made, then the city can start mobilizing on its transition activities, including crafting that transitional land use district and doing those other bylaw amendments that would be required. The city will also send out a transition handbook to all the affected households in the annexation area. This will summarize a lot of the information presented here today, as well as provide other important and useful information for new city residents. And I'll end the presentation by saying the city remains committed to ongoing communication throughout this application process. It will continue to update its website, issue newsletters, media releases as required, and take inquiries by email and by phone. So if you have any questions, please feel free to reach out to me by email or by phone listed here. That concludes the presentation segment of today's meeting. We'll move now into the live question and answer period. Hey, thank you for holding your questions during the presentation. We are moving into the question and answer period, and I'm going to shift the floor over to Beth Sanders, who is the moderator for today's question and answer period. And Beth has been working with the Annexation Negotiating Committee throughout this process, facilitating the discussions and the negotiations that led to the annexation agreement. So Beth was a natural choice to help out with our moderating the questions from you guys today. So here is Beth.
Thank you, Vicki. So my role today is to facilitate as many questions as possible being put to the panel and having as many of those questions answered in a clear and concise way that's helpful for you folks that are attending today. So we're going to have, you know, about 40 minutes to do this, but before we jump in with the Q&A, what I want to do is just lay out how this is going to work, because we're all in an unfamiliar environment. We would all far rather be face-to-face in a room talking to each other than making do with this Zoom world. So anyone who wishes to ask a question is going to need to identify themselves in some fashion. And there are two ways to ask a question. If you're on a computer, on the bottom of your screen, there's a little Q&A icon. And if you click on that, you will be able to ask a question. And I can see we've already got one there, so that's perfect. There's another way to ask a question, however, you might, instead of writing, you might like to speak your question. And if you'd like to speak your question, you can click raise hand on the bottom of your screen if you're on a computer, and I will be able to see that your hand is raised, and then I can call on you. We can unmute you, and then you'll be able to speak your question. Okay. No one's on the call on a phone, so we don't need to go into those tricky details. I make a commitment to you to go back and forth between the written questions and the spoken questions. And my objective is to have as many questions put to the panel as possible. So my ask for people asking questions is to ask a clear and concise question. And then my ask of the panelists is that you provide clear and concise answers. So I'm not going to put a time limit if someone is speaking a question, but I will interject if any clarification is needed. Same thing applies to panelists. If you're not clear in some fashion, I will interject there to help you be more clear, to make sure that the questions folks are answering are getting answered. In the case of the written questions, I'm going to read them all out loud. And in the event that a question has already been asked, I'll just say that it's already been asked, but for transparency, I'll still read it out loud. And we'll get through as many questions as possible. And if there's time remaining, we're good to be on the call till 3 o'clock. We'll make room for a more conversational feel. And a reminder to everyone that this call is recorded. So anything you type is recorded, anything you speak or others speak is recorded. I want you to be aware of that. But the other thing is after the call, if you want to re-listen to an answer, you have access to that. So just some tips. So this works all smoothly because we're all making do. is leave the chat function in Zoom for anyone who has technical questions, because we want to make sure that this is as accessible and inclusive as possible. And remember that you can write your question using the Q&A, or you can speak your question by raising your hand. And what I'm going to do, I see we've got two questions written, which is absolutely perfect. Just to help folks that are attending here, I want to let you know what kinds of questions these panelists can answer. So for example, Darren from ISL Engineering, He's a great person to put servicing questions, land use kinds of questions, how the annexation area, like all the technical kind of stuff there. Darren's perfect for that. Greg from Corvus is the financial guy. So taxation questions are perfect for Greg. We've got him on hand. From the city administration, we have Christina Peter, who's perfect to answer any questions about land use, future land use, planning, that kind of thing. And Vicky, who you've heard from, has all kinds of technical details about different kinds of servicing. And we have with us as well one person who was on the annexation negotiating committee, and that's Councillor Sheena Hughes from the City of St. Albert. And we are expecting Councillor Wayne Beauconfort from the county. He was also on the annexation negotiating committee. So when he arrives, we'll plug him in so he's available here on the panel as well. So with that, let's get started with our two written questions. The first question we have is from Gail. And Gail, if you can just insert your surname, I don't need to read it, but just so we know who Gail is, but Gail has a question that I'm gonna ask here, the panel. Just wondering if the city has a timeline of when the pieces of land included in the annexation would be developed. Does the city have a timeline? And Christina, I think this is a Christina question.
All right, so I may actually defer to Darren as well for a little bit of help with the phasing of development. But the timeline for development, we're looking at this being a 45-year land supply for the city of St. Albert. But of course, that won't all develop out at all at once. So we're anticipating that it'll take 45 years to get all of the lands incorporated and urbanized roughly within that time frame. However, it is really up to the local landowners to determine how fast the development will occur. Usually the land eventually ends up in the hands of land developers. And the way land development works, the most cost-effective way of developing land is for it to be done in a contiguous fashion. So that means that pieces that are closest to the existing servicing will get developed first. So if your land is located maybe closer to Township 544, you're probably looking at quite a long time before you'll see development in your area. But if you're located right next to lands maybe already developed, say north of the Costco, you may see your lands developed at a quicker pace, somewhere in the 5 to 10 year time frame. And Darren, do you mind expanding on that question?
Yeah, you bet. Gail, we've been involved in a number of annexation projects for the last few years, and what we've been finding is that it usually takes around 10 years for the developer to assemble the land, get it through the subdivision, the planning, subdivision, and development approvals processes, such that they're allowed to start putting servicing in the ground and so forth. So I would expect the earliest that we would probably see shovels in the ground would be 10 years. That's been our experience in other municipalities. That being said, there is, we know of one developer that does have interest within the annexation area and might already be priming their land. So there's a slim possibility that a development might occur within the 10-year time frame that I described today. But as Christina said, we do expect that the growth to occur kind of in a contiguous radial fashion around the existing City of St. Albert urban footprint, the extent to which it's developed now.
Darren, can you say what contiguous means, please?
Oh, right, yeah. Contiguous is being adjacent to existing development already, as opposed to skipping over, say, a parcel or a quarter section of the land and then starting fresh within the other
island. So land closer to the built-up area of St. Albert is going to develop first rather than the land further out to the north, say?
Correct.
Okay. Greg, do you have anything to add to this?
Sure. Well, as I mentioned in our last engagement session, I think it bears mentioning here again. Maybe at first I'll just emphasize that it's important that everyone remember that land won't develop without the consent of the owner. So if an owner wishes to keep using the land as it is now, they can do so in perpetuity. Development only occurs when the owner decides to develop land. That's the first thing. The second thing that I would mention is that I think a helpful resource that folks can refer to when the city completes its application, there will be technical documents in there. And there are a couple of very useful maps in those technical documents. One is a high level conceptual map of how land is anticipated to develop in the annexation area, which lands are anticipated to be residential, non-residential lands, et cetera. And second map is quite useful is a land staging map that shows how, at least at this point, lands are anticipated to develop in terms of timing. And so that would be useful for owners to refer to as well.
Thank you for that, Greg. All right, I have a second question from Frank Booth, who asks, with the annexation, will I have access to the St. Albert Compost Depot just north of Rural Road 260 and Villeneuve Road? And Vicky, how about you tackle that one? Access to the compost depot.
Mm-hmm. My understanding, and Christina can correct me if I'm wrong, is that residents of St. Albert can take household organics to that location. So you just have to bring proof of residency with you when you take your debris there. Now, I don't think that that is a location where you can take sort of farming operation scale or in more larger scale amounts of organics. But households, you could take that there.
Christina, do you have anything to add to that?
I think that Vicky's answered that quite well. Quite frankly, as soon as you become a resident of the city of St. Albert, you will have access to all of the amenities that we provide. However, there are a few things that we are still in negotiations with regarding waste management that we're working with the county and also with the independent Rose Ridge waste management facility. They're independent and we're looking at trying to get larger amounts of waste being delivered to them.
Okay, good. Thank you. Thanks for your question, Frank. I'm imagining there might be some other questions in our audience. A few more people have arrived. Vicky, while we're waiting for some questions to possibly surface, would you mind telling us about the virtual engagement that's happening online on the city's website?
Sure, thanks, Beth. The other component of these events that we're hosting via this Zoom webinar, we have sort of a sister event happening online. It's called a virtual information session. And what you do is you go to the annexation website off the city's website, stalbert.ca/annexation. And there's a link to the St. Albert's virtual information session. And when you click on that link, it takes you to a virtually rendered room, which would look a lot like what you would see if you attended an open house in pre-COVID days, where there's display boards arranged around the room in a circle. There's attendees standing by the boards reviewing the information. And so you can, via your computer, navigate through this room and go board to board and click on the boards, and the information pops up on your screen so you can see it. And then you can move to the next board. There's also a table in the room where you can access a PDF version of all of the boards. So if you wanted to download that PDF or print it off for future reference, you could do that. Also on the table, you'll find a link to the consent form. So if you're an affected owner and you're in support of the annexation, and you wanted to fill out a consent form online, you just have to take your unique identifying number that was provided to you on the invitation letter for this event and go online and fill out your consent form there. So it's a really interesting companion to this live webinar is to have a more of a static information session that you can revisit at any time during the day. That's available 24/7 this week, and we'll leave it up the remainder until the application is submitted to the Municipal Government Board, I would say. So that's another way to access information.
Yeah. So you spoke just now to what a landowner can do if they like the idea of annexation. What does a landowner do if they don't?
If if a landowner is in opposition to the annexation, first, the city would like to know, and it would be interesting to hear what the concerns are that landowners and other owners have about the annexation. And maybe that's a conversation we can have one-on-one. And if there are questions that didn't come up today and you have some concerns, perhaps through a discussion, those concerns can be resolved. And then you end up turning your mind around and you think that you do support it. If through a conversation like that, you still are in opposition, there's an opportunity for you to express your concerns in your opposition to the Municipal Government Board. And the Municipal Government Board will be reviewing the application. Part of that process is to set a hearing where affected parties can register to speak and voice their concerns in a public forum on the record. So that's where people who are not in favor, they have an opportunity to have their views set forth in a public forum there as well.
And could you just take a minute to remind us of the timelines? Like, the City of St. Albert has yet to make the formal application to the Municipal Government Board. You're going to do that when, and what can landowners or people watching this expect to unfold? Like, how long is this going to take?
Yeah, it's a process. I mean, it's taken us 3 years to get to this point. And so annexations are not fast things. Part of what we're doing right now, gathering this information, these final questions and concerns from owners, we're finalizing the reports that go into an application package that support the request to the province for the annexation. Greg mentioned some staging maps. Those maps are parts of background reports that are not yet public because they're not finalized. They're part of a growth management plan that's still being worked on. So access to that information would come after an application has been submitted to the Municipal Government Board and accepted by them. We expect to submit our application to the Municipal Government Board in the first couple weeks of December of this year. So then they start their process. Once they've reviewed, they will notify all the owners and affected parties and advertise to the general public that this application has been received. And if you wanted to submit any concerns or have access to the information, you just get in touch with the Municipal Government Board. They'll also notify you of when a hearing is scheduled. We're expecting, if we make an application by December, that we would have a hearing sometime in spring of next year. And we wouldn't expect an actual decision from the province until the end of 2021. So that's our timeline. So another year before we know whether that application for annexation has been approved or not.
Perfect. Thank you for that clarification, Vicky. A couple new people have arrived. So I just want to point out how to ask a question of the panel here. There are two ways. You can do it in writing or you can speak your question. To ask a question in writing, on the bottom of your screen, if you're on a computer, there's a Q&A icon. And if you click on that, you can ask a question. If you're on a tablet or a phone, what you'll need to do is tap your screen, and then that option will be evident to you. The way to speak a question is on the bottom of your screen, or again, if you tap it, you'll see raise a hand. And if you click on that, I will see that you'd like to speak. We can unmute you and then you can speak your question. And if you speak a question, there's also an opportunity to have a little bit of a back and forth with the panel, rather than a written question goes in and then the panel answers and then we can't really facilitate much of a back and forth. So just want to make sure folks know how to ask a question. And while we're waiting for another question to come in, and there doesn't have to be, we're here and available, but if the questions, there's a lot of information that Vicky presented at the beginning, and you may either have answers provided to your questions, or you may just wish to have some more time to digest. I'm going to ask Beth Frigo, who with the City of St. Albert, if she would please pull up that last slide, because on that slide is Vicky's phone number and email address. So if a question comes up for you later, you can reach out directly to Vicky, who you've met here. And the website address is also there. And Vicky was just describing the virtual information opportunities there, where you can get quite a bit more information that you can spend some time poring over. So I want to make sure that folks know that this is not the only place to get information. And just a quick check with attendees to see if there are any questions you'd like to ask, either in writing or to speak. And I don't see anything. What we will do is the panel's going to stay here for a few minutes at any rate. And if there are no questions coming, then attendees, I think you can feel free to leave much the same way as you'd leave a room if we were all there in person and nothing was happening. You can feel free to leave. We'll stay in the event that someone new arrives that has a question. Of course, if someone does have a question, we're here for it, but otherwise I think we'll close. So Vicki, any closing remarks from you?
Yes, thanks, Beth. What we'll say is that if you have any questions that come about after you've been thinking about it and something pops into your head, please feel free to give me a phone call or send me an email, and I'll be happy to do my best to answer that question for you or just have a discussion. If you are in opposition and you want to have a discussion about your concerns, also please feel free to give me a call. So when your questions come in, we note them down. It becomes part of the public record in much the same way this was recorded and will become part of the public record. I want to thank our project panelists who took time out of their days to be here to answer questions, and also wanted to remind everybody that you can submit those consent forms via regular Canada Post, by email, by fax. You can take a picture of it and send it. A lot of people have been doing it that way. It seems to be quite an easy way to do it. You can also go online to the city's website, fill out that consent form with your unique parcel number from your invitation letter, and submit that online as well. So with that, I would like to thank all of our attendees for participating. And again, feel free to move on with the rest of your day if you feel like you don't have any more questions for the panel. And thanks again, everybody.